Hey people, what is up? I want to show y'all one of my favorite watches. Now when I say favorite, I mean in my top five favorite. You know, it's just a great watch, and I'm going to tell you why it's in my top five favorite. I'm going to explain all that in a minute. But I have quite a number of watches, and my favorites include a variety of watches. You know, analog, digital, both, atomic. Maybe they're automatic, you know. There's really no rhyme and reason to which ones I choose as my favorites, but this one that I'm about to show you is easily in my top five. Now, let me get Shy Guy out of the way here. The one I'm talking about is the Casio Pathfinder PAW1300T-7V. And this is one of my favorite watches of all time. It's a great watch. And I'm going to go through and I'm going to tell you about what I think about it. We're going to cover the outside of the watch and then what's inside the watch too. So this might be a little bit longer, but bear with me. I'm going to tell you why it's one of my favorites. Now, first of all, you've got the exterior here. Now, right off the bat, I'll tell you, this one is not as tough as some of the G-Shocks. You know, this one is not really protected like that. It don't have big rubber case around it or, you know, nothing like that. But they are pretty damn tough watches. You know, I'd put them up there, right up under a G-Shock. And if you look around the case, the buttons are nice and large. Everything's, you know, pretty spaced apart where you can get to it easily. We'll talk a little bit more about what they do in a minute. The band on it, you see how it moves in, the little links here that connect to the case, they move in a lot. So when it's on your wrist, if you have a little bit smaller wrist, you're not going to have this bulge sticking out like this, you know, where the band does something like this. It's going to flatten out to your wrist on both sides there. So it is really comfortable, which I'll tell you about a little bit more in a minute too. The bracelet here is titanium. I like that. It's lightweight, strong, it's solid. If I can get it to focus. It's a solid, you know, link, and it don't pull your hair, nothing like that. It moves really easily, so it's, you know, pretty soft on the wrist. It has a soft feel on the wrist. Have to excuse me, I still got some congestion, but either way, one of the things I liked about this bracelet the most is just the quality of it. If you look at the clasp, it's a really well done clasp. You know, the way it sets on the wrist is real comfortable. And, you know, it's a higher quality clasp in my opinion. You got your little fold over here with your little peg. A little peg, of course, is like, for some reason I have a hard time focusing this camera in this light. But you got the little peg and that'll grab your clasp. Then, of course, you got your safety clasp, folds over and protects those two buttons on either side here from being, you know, pressed and deploy the buckle. I really like that a lot. You open the safety up, you got your two little deployment buttons, and there you go. I really wish that my MTG had something like that. This one, you just do that and then you got your two buttons. You have no safety clasp. You know, I love the safety clasp. This is my Seiko Monster right here. You look at this, it does the same type of thing. And it has a safety clasp as well, but it has the two buttons exposed right there. So once you open that, you know, you can still press them when it's buckled. Do that and then you press it. That's a nice band. I like this one a lot. I prefer it over something like this. You know, that this one has a safety as well, but once you do that, you got to kind of tug on it like that. I prefer the Monster's clasp to that, and I prefer this one to just about every clasp I have. I mean, I wish they would have put this on the MTG here. That would have been awesome. It's just real cool because, you know, you buckle it up, and when you do the safety clasp, it protects the buttons as well. So how much do you really need that? Maybe not a whole lot, but, you know, I've never had a problem with my Seiko Monster here. Once you close it up, those buttons are, you know, you can push them all you want. You're not going to get it past that safety clasp. So, you know, that's cool. It's better than not having one at all. But right here, I just really like the attention to detail on that. You know, you open that up, then you get your buttons. That's just, that made it worth it for me. I love the titanium band version because of that. Some of the Pathfinders don't have this style. They have more of a, you know, similar to this right here. Similar to that kind of clasp, you know, where you have the little, the fat little pieces like that that kind of sit together. Most of them have a safety clasp, but either way, this one is just really good. I love that, the way that that one piece right there sinks in between those. Kind of reminds me of this one. You know how it has that higher end look to it? I love that. That's one of the nicer clasps. This is a invisible type of clasp, but that just signifies higher end in my opinion. You know, some of your higher end watches have that. But enough rambling about that. Let's move on. So, let's take a look at the features, you know, inside the watch. You know, the case is real good. We talked about that. Oh, yeah, one thing real quick. The backing here is real flat, and it's not a real thick watch. You know, I got many much thicker watches. This is, you know, pretty low profile. It's a little bit, you know, the diameter is a little more than some of my watches, but not a problem because it rides really good on the wrist. Real flat here. It feels good on. So let's put it on and take a look at some of the features. All right. First of all, actually, let me take it back off. It makes it easier, huh? I can get up there closer, huh? But you got your main screen here. Tells you the day. There's a date, time, seconds. And if you'll notice, we got 45 seconds. You'll see this little dot, this little black dot moving around the perimeter. And that's basically like a analog top second hand. So you'll see it going around there as the seconds count. I thought that was a nice little touch. Maybe not necessary since you have your digital second display, but it is a nice little touch how you see that little dot going around there. And, you know, something extra. I like detail. Right down here, you got your low, medium, high for your solar power. Right now it's on high. Up in this little area, this little quadrant, you'll have three bars that'll either not be there, which is the case right now, or they will, you know, fill up accordingly, depending on your signal strength. And that's basically for your receiving indicator, for your atomic. If you got those three bars full, what's your best chance of receiving? So, you know, that's good. And, you know, you got your mode button right here, compass, barometer, altimeter. Down here, you got your adjust. That's how you set the stuff and your light. So let's take a look at some of the other modes. Basic watch stuff first. You go over here, you got a record mode. Now, basically what this lets you do is the data from your compass, barometer, altimeter, things like that, you can basically go through and check things that you've recorded. Now, I'm not going to go into a whole lot of detail on how it works. If you want to know, let me know. I'll tell you. But basically you can, you know, save memory of what occurred, you know? That's basically what the record mode is. So, there's that. World time, of course, you can go, you know, up and down, set your different cities. I got it on GMT right now. And while you do that, you got your home time displayed at the bottom. I always like that. Next mode, stopwatch. Pretty straightforward. Start it. You can split it and things like that. You know, you can have a two-stop function or whatever. And then reset, all that. Timer, same type of deal. You got your time displayed at the bottom. I like that. Got your timer. You start it. It'll start counting down while your home time is displayed at the bottom. So there's that. There's your alarms. That's your signal, your hourly chime. Then you got your alarm 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Straightforward stuff. That's your receiving screen. And if you push this right here, this will tell you, or it'll start receiving if you push in and hold that. It'll start trying to get a signal and, you know, update your time. And then, of course, you got your home screen again. Now, if you hold adjust right here, if you click it, you'll see up here you can change what's displayed. Right now I have it on Sunday. The date is always displayed, so it's Sunday the 13th. Hit it again, you get 313, so you got the month and the day, and then you have, you know, 11, which is the year. If you hit it again, you get a graph. Now, I'll tell you what that graph is in a minute. Now, this is the way I usually leave the watch right here during the spring months, which I'll explain in a minute. But this basically gives you a barometer readout. Okay? Tells you what's going on. So let's take a look at that right quick. Go over here to Compass. You've got your time displayed there, and it'll give you a direction. It'll tell you, see a little black arrow? Whatever way that's facing, it's going to read out to you right here, south, 171 degrees. Of course, if you do it this way, guess what? East, north, you know, it's a compass. Like I said, I'll explain a little bit. If y'all want to know more about it, I can help you. But I'm not going to go into detail right here. We'll go down to altimeter real quick. You got your time there, as most of the screens on this. Then you got, this is your 580 feet. This is telling you your altitude. That's what an altimeter does. You got an altimeter, like a range graph, you know, tells you if you've been climbing or descending, ascending or descending from a mountain or from whatever. This will tell you, give you a readout. And of course, you know, you can plot out, and the graph plots it out, and you can save it in your record mode and all that. Not a lot of detail on it. I'll tell you later if you want to know. Now, this is the most interesting to me, the barometer. Now, the reason for that being is, I know a few of you know, a few of y'all know about this, about me, but here in Texas, North Texas, we fall in what's called Tornado Alley. And I happen to be an amateur storm chaser. I've been interested in weather like all my life. And I really just love chasing storms. I love weather. You know, the more adverse, the more interesting to me. Whenever you see those squall lines coming in, you know, and you see those thunder and the lightning, and just the adverse weather is interesting to me, especially when it gets tornadic, whenever you start seeing that little hook in the clouds. I'm not going to go into weather on here, but that's another one of my hobbies, y'all, is storm chasing, you know, storm predicting, storms, and just weather. I love springtime in Texas because we get some good, nasty weather here. Now, this barometer, after all that rambling, basically does a number of things. It can predict trends, or, you know, it has a trend graph right here, kind of tells you what's going on with the barometer. Now, if you know how to read a barometer, you can get an idea of what the weather is going to be doing. Basically, what a barometer does, it measures the pressure in the atmosphere. And according to how much pressure is in the atmosphere, you can get different things happening. For instance, if the barometer is climbing like it was earlier, then, you know, you're looking better for weather. Your atmosphere is more stable, and, you know, it's generally better weather. Now, if it starts dropping like it is, has been over the past several hours, that's whenever, you know, your atmosphere becomes more unstable. And I can confirm right now, due to my weather radars and stuff, that we actually have a storm front coming in. We actually have potential for some severe thunderstorms here in several hours. So this is indicating, this barometer is indicating that the pressure is dropping. And of course, you know, the atmosphere is becoming unstable. So, you know, you can predict a lot of things, wind patterns, you can, or wind, snow, just, if you know how to read a barometer, what this means right here, you see that? INHG. If you know what all that means, you know how to read it, you can kind of predict weather more so than not. You know, of course, when you start messing with storms, you start chasing storms and stuff like that, you kind of get a feel for it too. You kind of can go out there and just kind of get a feel for what the clouds are doing. You can look at a radar, start seeing the shape of the clouds, the shape of the pressure in the atmosphere, all this shit. I'm not going to go into it with a lot of detail. If y'all want to know more about it, I will. But storm chasing is fun, y'all. I love storms. And then, of course, down here you got a compass, I mean a temperature readout, 77.4. That's just about correct. And, of course, I got it calibrated for whenever it's on my wrist. You know, you do get a little body heat coming off your arm, and then, you know, you got your sensor and all that. So you want to calibrate things as they're on your wrist if that's where you're going to be taking your readings from. Okay, so this is most accurate when on my wrist because that's how I calibrated it. But either way, I just thought I would share that with you about the barometer and the reason I like this watch a lot, because I am a weather junkie and it's one of my favorite things about living in North Texas, Tornado Alley, is the weather. In the springtime, I get really happy about the weather. When the skies darken and it starts looking grim out there and people start, you know, running for the hills and hiding, that's when I come out, y'all. I love it. So, there's that. What else about the watch, you know? I don't know. It's just a real good watch. It's got a good, bright display on it. It's atomic solar. Rides on the wrist good. It, you know, there's really not much not to like about it. It's one of my all-time favorites. You do have an EL light. Okay, see there? You got your EL if you need to see it in the dark. Pretty good. The only thing I wish about this watch is that maybe it was armored a little bit more, maybe like my MTG, around the buttons and such. I mean, you know, I don't really accidentally hit buttons on any of my watches, G-Shock or not, but I like how they're kind of sunk in there and protected. You've got some rubber around here. You've got rubber sitting above the bezel. And, of course, the screen is sunk in deeper. And, you know, they're armored up a little better, G-Shocks are. Pathfinders are good watches. You know, they're not armored up like a G-Shock, but they are tough. And, you know, I would prefer them be armored, but I'll take it like it is, too. It's a good watch. Does a little bit of everything that I want to do in a watch. And it's dead accurate. You don't really need a battery because you charge it up. And the damn thing can predict the weather, so, you know, what more do you need, y'all? Got a compass if you get lost. Know how to read a compass, that is. You know, this one actually has a feature where you can, you know, you can do true north, you can do magnetic north, and you can also have a bearing compass, like where you can, I'm not going to explain that either in detail, but if you got a map and you know about how to read a map and how to set a compass according to a map and all this, you can actually find your way out of a lot of places with a good compass. And, you know, this one's pretty damn accurate. You see how it blanked out right there? It stops reading after about 20 seconds. I presume that's to actually save battery life so it's not constantly seeking. But, you know, either way. Altimeter is good, though I don't use that as much. I don't know. It's just a good watch, y'all. If you look up to the skies in springtime, or whenever your weather happens around where you live, if you really like weather, if you like being outdoors, and you like, maybe you like hiking, maybe you like, you know, fishing, you know, the barometer can tell you a little bit about fishing, too. I don't know how many people out there, you know, are into fishing, but, you know, your weather patterns have a lot to do with when you catch fish and when you don't. So, you know, that's always cool too. If, you know, if you're into outdoor shit's what I'm saying. If you're into outdoors, if you like it outdoors and you want a good watch to help you a little bit outdoors, if you need that kind of thing, you know, even if you don't, you want a gadget. See, that's me right there. I like gadgets, you know. I got barometers. I got, you know, all kinds of gear, but this one, you know, it's cool. There's a barometer on your hand, you know, on your arm. So, I had to have it. But either way, that's the Casio Pathfinder PAW1300T-7V. Titanium. Damn good watch, y'all. And the retail on it's about $350. But you don't have to pay no $350 for it. If you look around, you could probably get it for a, you know, significantly less than that. Let me break this open real quick. If you look on my box here, it was $350 retail. I got it on clearance for $210 at a Sears, actually. I found it at Sears on clearance, and I had to get it. Because most of the other Pathfinders that are offering similar functionality with a titanium bracelet and a good clasp like this, most of the other ones were going for right around $300. So I got this one for about $210. Can't complain about that. All right, y'all, I'm going to get out of here. About 20 minutes of rambling about the Pathfinder. But for those of you out there that were wondering about, you know, how I felt about the Pathfinder as opposed to a G-Shock or whatever, well, now you know. I love my G-Shocks. I really do. But this Pathfinder is one of my top five favorites, along with several others I have, including this Seiko Monster here. But you cannot deny that if you put these two head-to-head as far as technology, this is old school, automatic. And, you know, been around, the automatic movement's been around for a while. Classic and old school. This one right here is cutting edge, and it's, you know, it's new school technology. So it depends on what you like, but, you know, like I said, my top five favorites do vary from old school to new school. But anyway, if you're looking for a Pathfinder, I highly recommend this model. There's a PAW1500T, I believe. I recommend that model. There's a couple of models with a resin band that are real good. I recommend them too. Basically, all your Pathfinders are pretty loaded watches. They got some healthy technology in them. So, if you know how to calibrate them right, you know how to use the tools that are on them, and you want a watch that'll do it, there it is, y'all. So I'll quit rambling about it, let y'all get on about your business, and I'm going to go watch those storms that are coming in and see what I can see. So, life's short, y'all. Stay sharp.